वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानंदं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं। दिस इवनिंग वी हैव अनदर इंपॉर्टेंट इश्यू ऑफ ह्यूमन लाइफ, दैट इज हाउ वी हैव टाइटल्ड दिस होल सीरीज एज Life's questions and Gita's answers. And this question we are considering tonight is, are sense pleasures death traps? Worded in a bit of dramatic language, this evening's theme, all the same, is culled from the scriptural heritage, where religious books from the East and the West have portions, have sections warning mankind in this matter of pursuit of pleasure. To give a little advance summary of what I shall touch on, we shall be seeing that pursuit of pleasure is built into every one of us, and we know what it does to us, how dangerous it is, and all of us, to less or more extent, control the urges in ourselves to enjoy through various sense organs. We can see that on one hand there is a certain amount of controlling, and on the other a whole lot of religious teachings too advise us to keep our pleasure urges under check. I shall try to show that control is not all there is to this issue of handling pleasure. While control does have a place, ultimately this problem of everyone seeking pleasure, feeling fulfilled at times, feeling miserable at other times, and all that, this problem of our relationship with sense pleasure in life is truly solved only through a whole understanding. Not just control, not just indulgence, but a mature understanding of what this pleasure seeking is all about brings about a transformation where we shall in a natural way find a balance between the two extremes of denial and indulgence. So I shall be attempting, friends, to show that life's questions are answered only when there is an all-inclusive understanding of life. Why do we, first of all, use such a word like death trap in this evening's theme? Are sense pleasures death traps? I once more say that all the religious traditions have portrayed a picture like that for understandable reasons. Everyone knows how the forbidden apple that Adam ate maybe Eve also ate, started a series of complications. Excuse my limited knowledge of Christian legends. But we know the forbidden apple that was not to be eaten. And Adam ate and the roof came down, if there was a roof those days. And you know how in Islam or in practically every religion of the world, there is the admonition, there is the advice on having to fast, having to restrain oneself, having to perform various austerities to such an extent that religion is many times equated with denial of pleasure, control of sense pleasure, and so on. In the Indian spiritual tradition too, in the Vedanta also, there is quite a bit said about how sense pleasures could be detrimental to one, could bind us. I would quote a verse from the celebrated work of Adi Shankara, Viveka Chudamani. It says, there are five animals, if you look around in nature, on the Discovery or National Geographic Channel, so to say. Adi Shankara did not mention that. That is my spicing of the description. If you look around in the world of animals, there are five creatures which are caught, which meet with their death because of one attachment in the case of each. Kuranga, Matanga, Patanga, Meena, Bringaha. This is the Sanskrit word. Kuranga is deer. The deer are trapped by hunters by playing some music. And the deer, listening to the music, stands still and the hunter shoots it down. Matanga, elephant. Elephant, male and female, in their desire to be with each other and in their excitement, come in contact with each other and forget everything. That is when many a time hunters easily trap, shoot, catch them. So elephants, being quite enslaved to the sense of touch, are trapped. This is an old verse in Shankara's Viveka Chudamani. Patanga is a butterfly. The butterfly, some forms of moth, they are very much attracted to a burning flame. I would say some form of moth are kept in mind here. And they rush towards the beautiful form of the flame and just die in the fire. Then there is meena, fish. And the fish are caught by the tasty bait that fishermen drop into the water. Fish too, I would imagine, have some intelligence, but they cannot resist. They take a chance and eat that piece of meat or a worm, and there is a bait, there is a hook, and the fish are caught. And lastly, Bhringa is the bee. And the bee is drawn to flowers by the fragrance. And many a time a bee goes deep into the flower, first attracted by the fragrance, then going into the depth to drink the nectar in the flower. And there are some flowers in nature, which close after a while. The bee is caught inside. Adi Shankara combines poetry and observation of nature to give a message for spiritual development of every one of us, and says, look,
Kuranga, Matanga, Patanga, Meena, Bringaha, Deer, Elephant, Moth, Fish, and Bees. Each of them has one attachment only, but they meet with their end. Naraha panchabhiranchita kim. You and I, human beings, in a sense described as the crown of creation, have multiple attractions. We have a weakness for form, we have a weakness for taste, we do have weakness for smell and musical sound, more so for praise. We have, in fact, attachments on the planes of all the five sense organs. Seeing, touching, smelling, hearing, tasting. We do not like to miss any. So Shankara said, we are in a precarious condition indeed. We don't know how, but our sense organs, the eyes, ears, nose, tongue and skin, have their urges. Shabdadibi pancha bhireva pancha panchatvamapuhu swagunena baddhaha kuranga matanga patanga meena bringa nara pancha bhiranchita kim is a shloka in the Viveka Chudamani, raising an alarm. Look, how risky is our position. One is enough to bring us to death and we have five of them in us. In the same way, to quote once more from that Viveka Chudamani, a beautiful Vedantic classic running into 581 verses, Sri Shankara, the author, says, Doshena tivro vishayah Krishna sarpa vishadapi Visham nihanti bhoktaram Drashtaram chakshushapyayam. Which means, sense objects are sometimes more dangerous than even a bowl of poison. And he argues, a bowl of poison, you know, takes your life if you go pick it up and drink the poison. Whereas sense objects, even by looking at them, they can lead to your death. Not that you immediately drop dead. But we see something beautiful and the mind says, I want to eat it, I want to drink it, I want to wear it, I want to enjoy this food and drinks and sex and various possessions. As I said, the eyes, ears, nose, tongue and skin, five sense organs, which Bhagavad Gita continuously refers to as Indriyani, the five Indriyas, are constantly demanding something or the other. Today we have access to a lot of food, drink and other pleasures, and in certain societies we enjoy a lot of freedom too, as is the case here. Even in some spiritual teachings, apparently freedom is given, and we have stories of how, in the name of experimenting with a free relation with sense pleasures, many have met with disastrous ends. With respect to food, I guess in this society now there is an increased concern about obesity. If we eat more and more, and if we eat just tasty food, if we just, you know, satisfy our palate, well, pictures are given. Other day in some magazine I saw a very nice picture, you know, a dateline, some 3000 BC, how the man was, a hunter. And then 2000 BC, a little change in the, you know, Homo sapiens in terms of how he looks. Then 1000 BC, then 0001 AD maybe. Then it improves. And the last one, 2003 AD, is a very bulky person going with a big king-size cup of Pepsi in hand. That illustration, spoke volumes about certain modern trends. The last one is not a superhuman being as Aurobindo or someone anticipated, rather someone who is unable to control, manage one's physical size. So there are some descriptions like this in lot of religious works where it is said our desire for sense gratification could mean lot of complications, loss of health, loss of peace of mind, loss of relationships, loss of even right thinking. One could be so enslaved. I once met first the mother of this middle-aged man who said, "Will you please give some time to my son?" I said, "What is the issue?" The mother is a very, very rich lady in Kolkata, an industrialist, citizen who comes in limelight very often. And she says, I was a bit surprised, what does she have in her family? Why does she want me to meet her son? "Oh, Swamiji, you must meet my son if you can give half an hour to him tomorrow." And then I learned that this son, whom also I had met sometimes in some functions, spiritual programs, I learned that day that he has alcoholism. He is unable to control. And for a while he controls, and then he breaks down. And just 2 weeks ago, he had taken his family to some resort, and all were watching, no drink at all and everything. And then he lied on the last day. He said to the family, "This was a wonderful vacation, and you see how much control I have. I did not even ask for one drop of it. And you know, the other day the telephone rang, I have a little business in this city. All of you fly back, I will fly tomorrow by the same flight." And he sent all others home, back to Kolkata. He remained in that other city, in the resort, and as soon as the family went back, he drank and drank and drank, and then fell down in the bathroom of the 5-star hotel, and he hurt his nose so badly. And in fact, 2 weeks ago it was, and next day when this son met me, who also is a very successful, very rich industrialist, businessman and whatnot, he even then had this bandage and the wound was healing slowly. So coated, booted, suited, as Swami Chinmayananda would often describe modern man of education and social status. Here was this gentleman, middle-aged, who could quote from all the books. In fact, I must tell you that to spend about half an hour with him was quite pleasurable because he is so educated. I talk on Shankara, he also says something very appropriate on Adi Shankara. If I talk on Western philosophy, about which I don't know much, he has so much more to say. You touch any subject, he has ready information. And after all that, I couldn't believe that he has any such problem. But when it hits, it hits. When it hits him, he is just helpless and hapless. Alcoholism, you know, the Alcoholic Anonymous, and how there is a worldwide movement to help people who at times, on a daily basis or maybe a certain frequency, go almost berserk without alcohol, without drink. For someone else it might be food, for someone else it might be music, for someone else it might be sex, so for someone else it might be something else. We don't know. For someone else, it might be just all those spicy Indian deshi food, you know, chakli and murku and namkeen and this and that, potato chips, something like that. The society considers alcohol or something as less respectable and doesn't make much of an issue of the potato chips. But philosophically, a weakness for the palate,
whether it is drink or this potato chips, is pretty much the same. Swami Chinmayananda often said to us, you may drink, but let not the drink drink you. A peculiar English indeed. You may smoke, but let the cigarette not smoke you out. You may enjoy a sense object, but let the sense object not govern you. Let the sense object not be your master. It is often said that the difference between a wise man and an ignorant man is just that in the case of the wise man, he controls the mind, and in the case of the ignorant man, a woman, the mind controls the person. So, how exactly do we see that we are above the mind? How do we see that our eyes, ears, nose, tongue and skin, the pancha indriyas, do not enslave us? They are our obedient servants or friendly tools, whatever expression you may like. How to come to terms? How to be at peace with all these sense organs? Scott Peck, the author of The Road Less Traveled, a good book, a bestseller indeed, says, in a study of tens of thousands of successful people around the world, conducted over a whole decade or more, he found that the common denominator of a large number of truly successful people who not only did well in their profession but maintained a good, balanced life, happy home, happy professional life and all that, he says, in overwhelmingly large number of successful people, in their cases, there was this ability, please mark the words, not to deny gratification, but the ability to delay gratification. You see the difference? Denying and delaying. Denying is for the Himalayan ascetic. Though we never know how many in the Himalayas actually are successful. It's not so easy. You go to the Himalayas and wear some robes and let's say live in a hut. You think the hut and the robes and the cold climate there makes you a great ascetic? You think next morning Ganga comes and gives you the gift of self-control? Everybody imagines by joining some ashram, by being in a spiritual center, maybe in the Himalayas or right here in US, and your state of California is known for all sorts of ashrams. Sometimes they say, sometimes I believe in the US itself, when they see something very odd, some new kind of spirituality, I believe the comment is, he must have come from California. This must be a California variety. Because this your state, California, is known for a great amount of open-mindedness. Next week, in fact, I am going to spend 2 days at this place called Ojai, near Santa Barbara. And other day someone said this Ojai, within some 50 miles radius, has something like 5,000 spiritual organizations. Their branches are there. Ojai alone has such a large number of spiritual organizations, Buddhist and Vedantic and, of course, Sufi and you name it, it is there. Along the length and breadth of this golden state, you have a lot of ashrams and you may imagine, well, enough is enough, I am going to join this ashram and then in peace, in great self-control, maybe on the third day you raise your hands and move, ready to bless the whole world. You know, I have achieved it, now thou shalt also achieve. Just come and surrender to me. One may have all wild fancies, but believe me, the place and some books and some symbols and some dress and some shaving of the head or growing some long hair and even some special dance, meditative dance you may call it, none of them can help you meet with the
pleasure urge in you in a mature way whereby war ends and peace comes about. Coming to peace with one's own senses and the mind is a very intricate affair. All the books talk about it, but hardly anyone truly arrives at that peace. In the Gita, Sri Krishna says, the desire in us to enjoy, to gratify ourselves, to feel good in some way, operates on several levels, and the first level is on the plane of the senses. Indriyani paranyahuhu, or Indriyani manobuddhi asyadhisthana muchyate. Such lines you find in the third chapter of the Gita. Indriya is the sense organs. And he says, if we have a reasonable accord, with reasonable, let's say, relationship with the sense organs, then the avenues open for sensible relationship with the emotional mind and the intellectual layer within us also. So that could scare us even more. If you think that sense organs are the only challenges, you are mistaken. That is only a beginning. Sri Krishna himself says, anyone who wishes to have inner perfection should begin with, let me call it, better management of sense organs. Scott Peck, I already mentioned, advises that we have an ability to delay gratification. I wish to eat something. I wish to watch some enjoyable TV program. And my mind says, oh, there is this homework, or there is that assignment, or this work is to be done, and I will do it after this program is over. And I'm going to watch only for half an hour. And that half an hour becomes 1 hour, 1.5 hour. With respect to pleasure, like a television program, let us say, we are able to stay awake even till 1 a.m., 2 a.m. Somebody, a youngster here only, put it humorously to me one of those days in the olden days. Swamiji, how is it sometimes that we don't have energy to push that simple red button in the remote control? I try, but just the thumb doesn't go down, she said. The program is very interesting. A little more, a little more, a little more. You change various positions. There is energy to change positions, but this one finger has no energy at all. Good old days, lot of wise people advised youngsters and summarized a whole lot of moral teachings in an expression, duty before pleasure. So it's just the sequencing. I persuade myself to do my duty first and then I go for pleasure. It can make a sea of difference to the quality of my life. And by going by Scott Peck's statistical studies, we are most likely to do well in a whole lot of our endeavors. Duty before pleasure. Just the sequencing. And this is delaying gratification. If we worded it in a bit different way, duty alone, no pleasure in my life, that would be denial. Delaying and denying are different. So delaying is putting work first, or putting something of value first. It need not always be homework or assignment or duty. Sometimes something of more value. Some service or some exercise, even some rest that my body needs, something that is of greater value is put first, and pleasure is put afterwards, It could be a milestone, it could be quite a great achievement. Eknath Ishwaran, who passed away a few years ago, who in this very California, operating from his center near Petaluma, made a name for his wonderful guidance in meditation in spiritual matters, evolved an 8-point program. Some of you perhaps are aware of it. An 8-point program for daily spirituality. And his book is a bestseller for many years. It was some years ago that the famed Hollywood actress Barbara Streisand found one of his books very helpful to her in leading a more peaceful life. And in a television interview where Barbara Walters asked her questions, Ms. Streisand said, "Well, one of the books that helped me a lot is this one by Eknath Ishwaran." And next day there were so many orders, I understand, at Nilgiri Press, the publishers, for that particular book which helped Barbara Streisand. And then after 3 days in many newspapers, it was reported also, one of the newspapers reported, "Barbara tells Barbara and book sales soar." Barbara tells Barbara and book sales soar. They had huge orders for that particular book. Now, Eknath Ishwaran, among those 8 points for daily spirituality, includes training the senses. We train our eyes, we train our ears, we train our tongue, we train our nose, we train our skin. These 5 are our constant companions. You know what makes it not so easy for you to transform by merely going to Himalayas is, when you go to Himalayas, these 5 accompany you. That's the whole problem. You could leave behind your spouse, for adult spouse, let's say, or for youngsters, you could leave behind those friends who get on your nerve, or those others who, you know, make it difficult for you to live a spiritual life, quote and unquote, etc. You say, "I cannot live spiritually here in this California. I'm going to go far away, up in Himalayas, Uttarakashi or somewhere." You leave behind everybody else, but can you leave behind your eyes, your ears, your nose, your tongue, your skin? These indriyas accompany you. We are coming. You set out, they said, "We are coming too." And there too, there is good food available, there are many pleasures available. Wherever you go, there you are. You have the same challenges. So, training the senses is how Ishwaran put it. No wonder in all spiritual programs there is some amount of advice on simplicity, some amount of advice on reducing the pleasure-oriented activities. Live in a simple way and learn something. Learn some chanting, learn some meditation, learn some concentration exercise, etc., etc. So delaying gratification, and then you have training the senses, a gentle self-persuasion. By the way, among many things that he says, Ishwaran would advise us in that book, Meditation, an 8-point program, that learn to stop before you are full with respect to a meal. Generally, we stop a few more bites after we are full. One more, and it's delicious. And you know, the Indian hospitality is rather dangerous. On one hand, your hosts tell you, "Come on, take just one more, take just one more." On the other, if they don't say this, Indian first generation immigrants among, you know, like me too, If the host doesn't press like that, we are very embarrassed. Because we expect that. It's a whole different culture. But the youngsters here have, of course, a more down-to-earth, straightforward outlook. So we tend to, let's say, eating food being an example, it could be anything else, any kind of indulgence in pleasure. We tend to eat and we are full and we take a little more because it is tasty. Weakness of the palate. And Ishwaran, in contrast, says, stop one morsel before you are full, one bite before you are full. Even as you know, yes, I think I shall be full soon. Stop a little before, which is going to be very hard indeed. Everywhere. For compulsive speakers, you know, I have the professional hazard of becoming a compulsive speaker. To start 5 minutes before the scheduled time is very difficult. We stretch a little more. I generally go 5 minutes beyond. Here also I think it has been happening. I am not able to overcome that so far. For last many years, people have commented, Swamiji, you always go 5 minutes more. You know. Because what happens is, at the end of it, I feel, you are very content, but I feel I have not explained something properly. Then I roll up my sleeves and, you know what I mean is, and so on. And generally my audiences like here are very sympathetic. All right, Swamiji. We are very clear, you have clarified it quite well, enough for the day. But if you wish to explain a little more, all right. So whether it is eating or speaking, in a number of activities, we tend to go a bit beyond the right quantity. Moderation, the best policy, goes the saying. Sri Krishna has in the 6th chapter, a shloka, yukta hara viharasya, yukta cheshtasya karmasu, yukta svapnava bodhasya, yogo bhavati dukkaha. Only she will be able to achieve yoga, a spiritual excellence, who is moderate in food, in speech, in sleep, in all activities of her daily life. Moderation is the key to spiritual attainment, to true inner growth, says Sri Krishna in the Gita. Touching on pleasure, he points out in his own way, to give an example, right in the 2nd chapter, he says, those of us who are unable to manage the pleasure drive in us get driven away, get carried away, just like a boat with sail up gets carried away by unfavorable winds. There is this celebrated verse, Indriyanam hi charatam yanmanonu vidhiyate tadasya harati prajnam vayurnavam ivambasi. On the surface of the sea, there is this boat with sail up and there are unfavorable winds, very strong winds, and the boat is driven in a direction in which we do not wish to go. So is the case with us when we have these weaknesses on the planes of the sense organs, and the mind follows those sense organs. The mind does not follow the inner voice, which has something better to say. The mind does not follow the value base within us. The mind rather goes by what the sense organs prompt. In that case, one is carried away in a wrong direction, says Sri Krishna. And in sharp contrast, in that very portion, in the 2nd chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, he describes somebody of wonderful, enviable, admirable self-control through the example or illustration of the tortoise, which withdraws its limbs at the slightest hint of a danger. The tortoise is a wonderful creature indeed in nature,
which has a hard shell and soft body and limbs. And if there is some danger in the forest as it is moving, let's say even an elephant is coming by and there is the chance of the elephant putting its foot upon this tortoise. I have heard that the tortoise shell is so hard, as it pulls in its limbs, the whole body is inside the shell. Even if an elephant puts its foot upon the shell, the tortoise survives. The elephant goes its way, and after a while, slowly, the limbs come out, and the tortoise gets going. So Sri Krishna talks about it. Kurmongani vasarvashaha is the Sanskrit expression in this particular shloka. Like that, a spiritually mature person has no difficulty in withdrawing the sense organs at the right time and letting them out at the right time. She is not a slave to the senses. The senses are under her mature control, says Sri Krishna. To quote a couple of other instances, there are in fact numerous instances on this topic in the Bhagavad Gita, but to quote one other occasion, and then two more examples I shall be citing. In the fifth chapter he says, one of the things that you and I should realize with respect to this matter of pleasure is, no pleasure, however wonderful it may be, is everlasting. Every one of them begins and ends. He makes a philosophical remark in the 22nd verse of the 5th chapter. Yehi samsparshaja bhoga dukkhayonaya evate adyantavanta kaunteya nate shuramate buddha. Adi is beginning, anta is end. Even this will pass away. The greatest pleasure passes away. Like night following day and day again following night in life, whether we like or not, pleasure comes to an end and pain begins. Pain comes to an end and pleasure begins. Of course, there are other things also like boredom and stress and many other things. All of them come and go. All these emotions, joy and sorrow, excitement and depression, fear, and so many of mental states, they come and go. It is all a passing show. Do we recognize this? Do we recognize this changing nature? Do we recognize that not only pleasures come and go, but also we who seek pleasure come and go, we change. Some years ago, we would have sought very intensely one kind of pleasure. After a while, we sought another kind. Today, we might be seeking a third kind. We acquire new tastes. We acquire new interests, new hobbies, new... Riding one way, we look at the whole world as just this object. I get this, I am done. But another time we just say, I am not interested in that particular position or pleasure, power, etc. So I would like to, at this point, remark, and slowly I shall take you to a deeper realm of the whole matter. Not just the object, but the seeker of the object is also a variable. The object has adi and anta, beginning and end. The seeker, the me, who wants a particular pleasure, also has a beginning and an end. Or to put in more understandable terms, the seeker also undergoes changes. The subject and the object. I am the subject desiring something. Let's say potato chips are the objects that are desired. The desirer and the desired, here are two. My palate, my tongue, and then eyes, ears, nose, tongue, skin, etc. They are on the side of the subject. The subject has many layers.
Who is seeking potato chips? Let us say. I. Who am I? Well, I am my tongue, and I am my mind, I am my intellect, and I am so many things. So I am a composite entity. And in this composite entity, having many, many layers of personality, having many, many conditionings, constantly changing, there is the rise of what we call desire, an urge to seek pleasure. When I first came to US in 1993, someone offered some pizza to me, and the cheese in it was not to my taste, but somehow I managed. But after some days, second time somewhere again, I ate some pizza. It felt a bit better. And after some more times of helping oneself to pizza, I began to like it. But people did not offer enough to enslave me. I have not eaten so much by humor. I don't like it so much these days, but I am quite happy to eat it once in a while. But my point is, at the beginning, it was not in taste. Its smell and its, you know, the whole feeling was a bit odd. In Monterey, in Marriott Monterey, we had a camp in December 1993. I had just arrived in November 93, and some four of us went there for a survey before the camp began. And the hotel fellow offered to us, "I'll give you lunch today, my present to you," and all that. So, you know, the officer there, the person. That was my introduction to pizza. I'm sure you have many similar experiences, how something first time doesn't interest you much. Later on, you get a taste, you begin liking it. It applies to all the pleasures. And alas, in couple of situations, a certain pleasure enslaves us. That's how Swami Chinmayananji said. He used the word comforts. We could jolly well say it with respect to pleasures. He said, "Comforts come to us as guests and linger on to become hosts, and they enslave us," he said. First, the television is a guest. Later on, it is the host, and we are at its mercy, in a manner of saying. So, the me in me changes. Its taste changes. And there is a certain variation. Seeking very strongly, sometimes seeking moderately, sometimes not seeking. So there is a variable outside, there is a variable inside. And to quote Sri Krishna once more, and one last time from the Gita shlokas, in the 18th chapter he talks about pleasure, using the word sukham, a certain happiness that is generated in various ways. He says, the best form of happiness in life is calling it sattvika sukha. When one goes about it with certain inner austerity, with certain inner effort, with some hardship, the dramatic or the poetic word he uses is visham, that is poison. Yattadagre vishamiva pariname amrutopamam tatsukam sattvikam proktam atma buddhi prasadajam. I would put it in this way. If you and I go about life with a certain alertness, with a certain responsibility, with certain greater amount of observation, the way is not so easy. It's a bit of an uphill task to be always watchful, to always think twice before doing something, as the idiom goes, to look before you leap. To always look before you leap is a bit hard. So in an exaggerated word, it is called vishamiva, like poison, very hard. Oh, I don't want to think about it. Just enjoy, just go. What's there to think?
that would be easy, line of least resistance. But to be a bit thoughtful, to be a bit alert, is generally a bit hard. It's going against the current. And once more, it applies not only to sense pleasure, but even emotional habits also. And even thinking patterns also. Broadly, we are bound, we are constricted when habits govern us. We experience an expansion within when we have some habits, but there is a certain intelligence overseeing those habits. Sri Krishna is referring to that kind of intelligent living. No one can be free of habits. But the issue is our habit passed through a bit of a test? Are we a bit aware when habitually we are saying something or eating something, doing something or stepping back from something? If we are aware, that makes a difference. If we are blind, if we act like machines, then that's where the trouble is. Agre vishamiva pariname amrutopamam, he says, the alert living is an uphill task. The mature living has sometimes great amount of discomfort. To go back to the way I put it before, to put duty before pleasure is very many times an uncomfortable feeling inside us. But those of us who gently see to it that we don't jeopardize our work, our duty, or things of greater importance through an undue amount of leaning, undue amount of seeking of pleasure, will have, as the shloka, as the verse says, pariname amrutopamam, will have a whole new dimension in life of certain peace, certain poise, certain deeper satisfaction. Basically, spirituality is about bringing to life a greater happiness. It's a sheer misunderstanding if we think spirituality is to mortify ourselves or deny things to ourselves and then probably get some supernatural powers. Somebody did not eat for a long time, did not drink, did not talk, and grew very long hair, did not go to barber, and at the end of that great austerity, this lady is able to read others' minds. Wow! This is very meaningless. Who wants to read others' minds when our own minds are so troublesome? One mind itself is such a big such problem to handle. And if we read others' minds, you know, it will be big trouble. Walking on water, unnecessary. Flying in air, unnecessary. Seeing through the wall, you know, unnecessary. X-ray vision and all those things, unnecessary. What we need really is being able to live harmoniously, being able to meet situations of life with greater balance, giving our best, loving and receiving love. And pleasure is not to be equated with love, obviously. Sense pleasure is part of life, could be part of a happy life, but it is not equal to love. Love is, in fact, very hard to describe. Love is something so subtle. What we actually seek in life from childhood till the last breath of our life is love. And that love is very subtle. What is it? It is a way of looking at others and looking at oneself. Love is when we feel we are one. You may be very educated. I did not go beyond sixth grade, let us say. In spite of that difference, I feel one with you. Then there is love. I don't feel inferior. I don't feel superior. I don't feel I am better than you. I don't feel I am less than you and therefore envy you. So without going into that digression, love is a state of mind, a way of being, where in spite of a lot of differences, there is a sense of we are one, we are together. And that applies to various relationships. And towards that, mature handling of pleasure assumes great importance. Now, let me touch on this deeper dimension which I already brought in. There is the pleasure, and we are asking the question this evening, are pleasures death traps? Are they big trouble zones? Are pleasures to be avoided? If we unintelligently avoid pleasures, potato chips and ice cream or whatever, if you unintelligently avoid, obviously there will be suppression, there will be a certain artificiality about us, there will be a refusal to see our mind as it is, there will be, in the unintelligent denial, a certain artificiality of wanting to fit into some picture, maybe that I read in a book. And that's not going to help. An unintelligent indulgence, of course, will not help, for that will make us enslaved. Truly enough, we become so dependent on the drinks, on the food, on the pleasure, on, once more, taking liberty to extend to the plane of emotions, that is, go beyond the sense organs. Emotional dependence is also a slavery. But leave emotional plane apart, come back. A dependence on sense objects, food, drink and everything, would come in the way of seeing life as it is. A pleasure-centered life, as we may call it, cannot bring the overall beauty to life. Pleasure-centered. Like you have the word workaholic. I wonder if there is a word pleasureaholic. One mother, of course, said to me once, her child is milkaholic. The child wants more and more milk. Milkaholic has been coined, and so many other holics have been coined, but I don't know. Is there a word pleasureaholic? So if we are pleasureaholics, like workaholics, then we are so much, you know, our perception is spoiled. Wherever we go to a beautiful place, rather than seeing the beauty of nature, Coke, 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 Pepsi, 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 potato chips, let us see. I'm giving the same examples. Youngsters, don't imagine Swamiji has a problem with potato chips. Please don't bring a box of potato chips tomorrow. I think, you know, sometimes we give some example, next day it comes. You know? Yeah. Looks like you wanted one. In good humor. Well, I request you to find out which pleasure drive is primary in you. Sometimes it could be sleeping also, the comfort of the bed, pull the rug, pull the comforter. And even if you don't get sleep, wish, pray for sleep. God, give me some more sleep. On the planes of the senses. Now, I already raised the dimension, the me. Now I shall say, by not being a control freak, I think there is that word, control freak. Don't look at everything as something to be controlled. Control has a place, but don't be a control freak. Like they say, Abraham Maslow, I believe, said, somebody who is good at hammer looks at every problem as a nail. So that way, sometimes you and I, becoming control freaks, look at everything as to be controlled. This is to be controlled. You know. No. Control is a certain operation which has some validity. Certainly, if things are going out of hand, we have to put the foot down and control. But the more beautiful thing that we may do with our mind, with our senses, is to understand, watch. Just as in education, it is one thing to say, do this, do that, don't ask questions. But another, to help the student find out for herself how something is so. To cram information into the head of students is not mature education. To make them memorize a whole lot of things is not true education. We all know it. A good teacher, it is rightly said, makes the students find the subject interesting, arouses interest in the subject. Then the student herself or himself goes into the subject. Hey, this is very nice, and so on. In the same way, can you handle your sense organs, eyes, ears, etc., with more maturity? Once more, neither indulging nor bluntly denying, while adopting the policy of moderation, as the senses demand, senses rise in storm, do you have the ability to watch? And here I would say, and it's a very important point, please, though we say sense level and mind level, and let's not go into mind level, let's see the level of senses alone, really speaking, what complicates this issue of pleasure is the intermixing of mind and body. Here is my pleasure drive, and it is not a watertight compartment. It is not actually, it cannot be isolated. My pleasure drive has, for 1 ounce of the sense being programmed, the tongue, for example, being programmed, has pounds and pounds of my mind being programmed. To what extent is my desire for potato chips in my tongue? To what extent is it in my mind? Is a question that you need to go into. And what makes it more complicated is, let's say to some extent it's in my tongue. Tongue has been programmed, because these are all programmable devices. Eyes, ears, nose, tongue, skin, mind. I wonder, pranas also probably, I have not thought really about it. In our Vedanta works we talk about 5 sense organs, 5 organs of action, emotional mind, thinking, intellect, the memory, the sense of ego, and 5 pranas, vital airs. There are a lot of components that make the personality, and all of them are programmable, mind you. And we are understanding this program. We don't want to remove the whole program. You know, you come to repair a computer, okay, I'll fix it. And you knock out all the things, including the operating system. Now, no problem. It won't work also. That's not debugging, right? When you set a computer right, you don't knock out all the programs and then say, no, you know, now it won't make any so noise. Your problem was making noise. No, thanda ho gaya bilkul. Kaam bhi nahi karta hai. It won't work also. In the same way, this denial and control in a brutal and meaningless and ruthless way does that to one. One makes oneself dysfunctional or non-functional. You know, it's not to drive away the ability to distinguish between salt and sweet in the tongue that is desirable. In the name of, you know, I used to be a slave of my palate, now I have conquered it. My only problem is I can't distinguish which is salty, which is sweet. Rama Rama, is it what we want in the name of conquest of the senses? No. In fact, it is said that someone who is truly spiritually mature has a very sharp taste. In fact, someone like Swami Chinmayananji used to, you know, you make some Indian preparation especially in right way, he would immediately know how well made, he would say. He had not made his senses lose their, you know, what do you call it, sensitivity, or lose their capacity to discern. Rather, in true spirituality, the senses do discern, but they don't go amok. They don't go berserk. And that is a delicate affair. Please see this. So I would put it this way. I have various urges for pleasure. And yes, we are highlighting the plane or the sphere of sense organs, agreed. But without a choice, we need to recognize that sense organs have a deal with the mind, with the intellect. For 1 ounce of craving located right in the sense organ, there are pounds of craving located in the mind. And what makes it more complicated is the mind, in addition, has a lot of beliefs also. Maybe religious beliefs, do's and don'ts, should and should not. All of them come together and make the scenario very noisy. Therefore, Oscar Wilde once said, the best way to deal with temptation is to yield immediately to it. Because he noticed a lot of people who would look at a pleasure object, let us say, and because they are well-read and they have gone to the church or temple a lot, and they have read, stuffed all that in the head, they are drawn, but they hold back. They are drawn, they hold back. And after a long struggle, they yield and eat. So he says, why all that? If you are anyhow going to eat, eat immediately. Save time at least. That kind of logic, Oscar Wilde's, you know, witty statements. Best way to deal with the temptation is to yield immediately. This is not the summary of my evening's talk. At such times, I need to go 5 minutes more and clarify. Otherwise, the consequences are disastrous. So, the craving is located in the sense organ. The craving is located in the mind, in my thoughts. And in addition, in my thoughts, there are a lot of shoulds and should nots, good and bad. And there are even secular conditionings. That it's a wonderful thing to go with maybe a Pepsi in hand on the street. It's the latest in thing, let us say. Some ideas of, you know better what is the fashion in the country here. But some kind of notion of fashion, like models do. You see on the TV somebody walking with something in hand. Or at home also to have such and such pleasures in ready access. Maybe certain social conditionings too. Both prescribing and prohibiting. Some way of life, some way of eating, some way of consuming, some way of, like you open a champagne bottle and that goes up and let's say, that's how we want to celebrate the new year now. Are you coming, Swamiji? Suppose you say. Now, see, it doesn't touch the palate, but that sight. You open something, you champagne and wow, and so there are whole lot of social conditionings, not just religion. Don't blame only the church, but everything in the society. So with all this, I meet with pleasure. Can you see? I'm sure the youngsters also can see. This is no complexity. This doesn't require, you are studying some big philosophy. All that I'm saying is, the pleasure urge has behind it certain programming of the sense organ, certain conditioning of the mind, and that conditioning includes notions of shoulds and should nots, desirable and not desirable, fashionable and not fashionable, and all those things. And how many of us are aware when we are drawn towards a pleasure? That so many factors are involved. Generally, all we know is, it is so nice, I want it. Can I have it immediately? Or should I wait? Like that, generally just tip of the iceberg. There is so much more. And what I am talking is not that one should analyze and dissect and write a 5-page paper on it. It's not an academic exercise I am suggesting here. the art of living is not academics. Of course, people can work on this, write a paper, and maybe someone can, you know, go for a PhD also. My thesis is mature pleasure management. Maybe in some psychology department, or, you know, who knows, it's possible. But that's different. I am saying we here are interested in living maturely, learning life, and we are interested in ridding ourselves of immature notions, immature waves, immature vibrations, immature activities in the psychological plane or psychological sphere. Therefore, the thrust of all my talk is to be aware of all the factors that keep this candidate called pleasure drive in the run. Who has put this candidate in election? You use that expression, right? This candidate is running for council, let's say. Now, pleasure drive I am personifying. My pleasure drive is running for fulfillment. It is seeking. It is up and running. Who has fielded this pleasure drive? One more thing. To what extent is it biological? To what extent is it psychological? To what extent is it put in us by God? And to what extent is a certain pleasure urge product of social conditioning? Whatever God has put in us cannot be wrong. Whatever nature has put in us cannot be wrong. But we, with our confusions, attach value and introduce some new component, we make this pursuit of pleasure a very complicated affair. And I would say that as we become aware of so many factors and we sort them out in that intelligent seeing, we rid this pleasure drive, we rid it, or we free it, we free the pleasure drive from unnecessary junk components in it, then it is a harmless thing. The genuine desire for pleasure in the human personality, as God made us, is an utterly harmless thing. One can be very much at peace with it. But this harmless pleasure drive becomes a gigantic affair. By resisting and suppressing, by shoulds and should nots, and by somebody wanting us not to do it, and then we say, if you say you don't want us to do it, we will do more. That's what we call reaction. All the psychological components come into the picture, and pleasure becomes a complicated affair. Are sense pleasures death traps? Sense pleasures, as God made them, are not at all death traps. They are simple, innocent, harmless things. But you and I, at a given point of time, alas, are already caught in lot of notions, lot of ideas, lot of concepts which are not facts, lot of beliefs. And in the medium of these beliefs and concepts and values, and which appear as should and should not, etc., the sense pleasures pretty much become death traps. For they confuse us, confound us, they throw us totally off balance. They make us judge ourselves as good or bad, right or wrong, virtuous or sinful. And they make us judge X and Y as there goes a sinful fellow, here goes a, you know, virtuous lady, and that is a righteousness personified, and this is, you know, sinner number one, or all this. So the complexity of the mind needs to be noted, And thus, without giving very specific formulas at this moment, let me conclude my talks.